Welcome to another edition of our PBS NewsHour Weekend Facebook Live Conversations. It's a chance for you to ask questions of our guests. So, as always, do so in the comments section, and we'll get to some of those in a few minutes. And portions of this conversation may appear on our broadcast at a later date. Today, we're talking about what's happening in a podcast called Reply All. Their most recent episode is about something that happens to so many of us, a spammy phone call from a random 800 number. But most of us don't do what Alex Goldman did. To help explain, here in the studio is Alex Goldman. Thanks for joining us.
Thanks for having me.
All right. We all get these. What made you want to, well, first of all, what did you do?
I got someone on the phone who was trying to sell me tech support, telling me that my iCloud had been compromised, that my computer was being looked at, my bank account was being looked at. And I knew right away that it wasn't true, but I was curious just how far I could get this person to go in terms of admitting what their business model is and sort of keeping them on the line. Surprisingly, he was very candid with me. And so I thought, oh, okay, so I got a phone call, told me to call back a 1-800 number. I'm just going to keep calling this 1-800 number back and see what happens. And I managed to learn quite a bit about the company that actually got in touch with me.
So this is a scam. They're running a scam. How do they make money?
Essentially what they do is they tell you you have a virus when you don't. They will remote access your computer and run a bunch of commands that are totally sort of pedestrian for someone who's a programmer, but to someone who doesn't know computers super well, look terrifying. And then they will say, we can fix this non-existent problem for anywhere from $100 to $400.
So this is happening. Yeah. This is happening all day long, 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, 365 days a year. And it's lucrative enough where they can keep doing it.
The call center that I got in touch with had around, at different times, between 50 and 100 people working there. So lucrative enough to employ a significant amount of people.
I just want to play a little clip here of when you got in touch with these guys.
People who don't know anything about computers.
So you're asking him, hold on, let me cue this up.
Why would I?
Because
you guys have a lot of money, that's what you spend.
Who is you guys? Who are you?
So this conversation, you started your question.
How much of that do you?
You started with the question is, don't you feel bad about scamming people? And this guy had no compunctions.
Yeah, he didn't seem all that upset about it at all. And to be perfectly fair, the people who are actually manning the phone calls in a lot of these situations, not in the greatest situation in terms of their financial well-being. People are not getting paid a lot. Some people are getting paid about $200 a month. Maybe less.
You know, there was a section in there. You actually went out. This was kind of some old-fashioned shoe leather reporting virtually that I really, really am happy that it actually happens in acts of journalism today. You figured out who used to work for this company and started talking to them, some of them on the phone.
Right.
And quite a few of them seemed not to want to give their name to you. And I just want to play a clip of a guy who kind of feels threatened about it.
Yeah.
If they get to know, you know, that I have given you my information, they have my resume, my home address with them and everything. They have my phone number and everything. So, you know, they might, you know, send cops to my place and tell them that I have, you know, stolen their data or their company information and all that stuff.
I see.
A totally shady operation. These are people who are, one of the employees complained that he wasn't getting paid.
I'd say that five or more people that we spoke to said, yes, either I wasn't getting paid at all, or when I put in my 2 weeks, they stopped paying me for my last month. One person said they always figure out a way to short your paycheck. So if you are supposed to get 10,000 rupees, you would get 8,000, and they'd give some excuse. People were all chronically underpaid or not getting paid at this company.
You know, you developed a rapport with a couple of the people that you talked to. And what happens here, what was kind of an interesting turn in the story, is that you're not fighting about it.
I kind of thought that the less indignant I got about it and the more curious I was about it, the more interested they'd be to talk to me. If I were furious the whole time, if I were, you know, telling them that what they're doing is a crime and they should feel terrible, et cetera, they'd probably just hang up on me. But if I was genuinely interested, which I was, it seemed more likely that they would be willing to talk to me, and they were.
And they started telling you all this stuff about the internal workings of the company. And then, you know, I strongly encourage our listeners and viewers that are watching on Facebook, and I was just go ahead and listen to the whole 50 minutes. We're not doing it justice by trying to summarize it for you. But You actually, I mean, this guy gives you his cell phone number and his email address.
Yeah, I was truly surprised by that. I expected that he was going to give me a fake number because he gave me actually an American number because he was using what's called Magic Jack, which is just a way
sure.
to, you know, use an American
We've all seen overseas. Those late night commercials, yeah.
Right. So he was using Magic Jack with an American number, and I fully expected it to not ring to anything. I fully expected his email address to bounce back. But I called him, and he picked up. It was totally blown away by that.
Okay, so one of the reasons that we have you here is that there's a cliffhanger at the end of this episode.
Mm-hmm.
We hear the sounds of you, and I'm very familiar with the sound of an Indian flight attendant speaking over the public announcement, of, you know, put on your seatbelts and so forth. You're heading to India in this episode.
That's true, yes.
How did this happen? I mean, this was you didn't go into this when you got this spam phone call. This six, seven months ago, this wasn't your intent was to make a story out of it.
Honestly, my intent wasn't to make a story out of it at all. One of my coworkers listened. We just recorded it just to sort of blow off steam. And what my executive producer, Tim Howard, listened to it and was like, what are you doing? Call back. So I can fully credit him with taking the initiative to sort of get me that interested in it. The person who I was talking to, who ended up being sort of one of the managers of the company, said to me, you know, if you ever come to India, look me up. I'll take you out. I'll show you around. And I think it was, I feel like everything that I said and everything that the folks at the call center said in this story was a bit of a calculation. I wasn't sure how honest he was about it.
Yeah.
But once he said it, I wasn't going to say no. I had to try.
And you've already done this. So
yes.
You took him up on the offer.
Yes, I did.
Say, okay, so listen, what if I actually just show up to India? Are you really going to take me out and around the town?
And again, I figured I'd get there and he just wouldn't pick up his phone. But he did. He did.
All right, without giving away the farm, the next episode drops this Thursday. What can we expect?
Without giving too much away, this first episode is a story about... in this first episode, there's a lot of twists and turns where people say they're one thing and they turn out to be another, and like I'm not sure who to trust.
Yeah.
That feeling very much carries overseas to India. It is a very, there's a lot of surprises.
Okay.
I don't want to give away too much.
That's fine.
That.
How long did it take when you were on the ground in India?
I was there for about a week. It was me and producer Damiano Marchetti. So we were there from Monday night to Saturday night. We really had very little time, so we kind of.
You know, when you're there, in the middle of episode one, there's kind of an interesting turn where you're sort of stalking them. You know, you're going through Facebook, you're going through LinkedIn, and they're getting increasingly annoyed. They're swearing at you when you call them.
Right. I mean, one of the things we were talking about a lot while we were making this was there was, at the very beginning of the episode, my first name's actually Michael, and, you know, he calls me by my first name, and there was this sort of weird power imbalance where this person somewhere in the world that I didn't know, new information about me that I don't readily give up. And I thought to myself, this person's trying to steal money from me and they know information about me that I'm not super comfortable with them knowing.
Mm-hmm.
What would it take for me to sort of flip that equation on its head? Like what would happen if I tried to learn everything about them? And would it be possible?
And you said before, they take, or you authorize them to take a look and view your screen and your computer screen.
Mm-hmm.
What did you do with that process to sort of turn the tables on them?
Well, one of the things we did was, Tim Howard, my executive producer, suggested, hey, you've looked at their Facebook profiles. You know a lot about these guys. Why don't you just put a picture of them on your desktop background and see how they react? And it caught them totally off guard. I figured they'd just hang up on me. Instead, they put the boss on the phone.
So the scammer is on the phone with you, taking a look at your computer, and then all of a sudden he sees pictures of his coworkers
yes.
on your desktop
yes.
background. He's like, wait, there's something off with this.
Yeah, the best thing is there's a moment of silence, and then he just says, okay. And his uncomfortability is kind of...
Some questions from Facebook. Can you ask if this episode of Reply All, Kevin Dando asks, it has received an unusually large response? I've seen mentions of it in quite a few places this week.
It has received probably the largest response we've ever had for an episode, and I've never seen anything like it for us.
Alan Morris, simple question. What's the best way to deal with these calls?
The best way to deal with these calls is to hang up and whatever information you have about them, phone number, or if you get a pop-up on your computer telling you to call a number, or if you get an email telling you to call a number, anything that says that you might have tech support problems, there is a place to complain at the FTC. And you should go to the FTC website and let them know. They are constantly looking for legal avenues to deal with these.
Beth Grant Arus asks, I wonder, are these centers in places like India because people are so desperate for work and the laws are lax?
So there's a lot of legitimate call centers in India, way more than there are illegitimate. Some are massive, some are very small, where American companies will subcontract with them so they can take calls for them. You know, Expedia is a good example. I called them the other day and I got a call center in Gurgaon, which is just south of Delhi. That's correct. There are a lot of people who are in pretty desperate situations. And one of the people I spoke to said, you know, it's either work here or work at McDonald's.
Yeah.
And this pays better. I didn't know going into this that it was a scam. It's only after being trained for a month or two that I figured it out. And by then, I'm stuck. I either work here or I go home.
Wow.
So,
you know, there's people that are kind of sharing their own kind of horror stories. Missy Michelle writes, they did this to my husband, and when they asked for payment, he came and got me, and I asked who he was talking to, and he said Microsoft, so I logged in my PayPal, and they started controlling it. In the end, PayPal gave me my money back. Once I found out it was not Microsoft, they continued calling my husband till I cussed them out, and then they gave up. But it's really tragic because it really doesn't take, I mean, you know, you're much smarter than the average person when they hear this robocall. All it takes is, you know, one good sucker and they've made a couple $100.
I don't think it's unreasonable when someone says, hey, you know, your account has been compromised. Hackers have control of your bank account. That's not unheard of. We hear about data breaches all the time where people's usernames and passwords get leaked en masse. So when you get a call like that, it taps into something that's very real. I don't blame anybody for taking these seriously. But I will say, Apple, Microsoft, they will never, ever call you. So right. If you get a call from someone claiming they're Microsoft or Apple, it is not them. Don't continue the phone call.
As a success of this episode, I mean, is there a line of podcasts or videos that could just do this all day long? Are there that many scammers out there that we could be going after?
I'm sure there are. We talk about scammers a lot on our show. You know, the problem is that a lot of scammers are actually very good at covering their tracks. It's a lot harder. There was a lot of luck involved in this. We got a phone call and then we were able to track that phone call back. But some of these phone numbers are up for 4 hours and then they're gone. So it's very easy for these people to slip away because the barrier, technological barrier to actually do this is almost non-existent.
Karen McClellan writes, Alex looks nothing like I imagined, and she has a smiley face, but this is always what you get when this is the guy behind the mic.
I'm sorry to disappoint you.
No, is there a way that, I mean, this is sort of just the internet is a global place, right? This is a person who's pretending to be an American or at least a Western name. He's sitting there. He's got a phone number that's looks like it's from the United States. I mean, there's not really a structural way to stop this. I mean, there's going to be people everywhere that are trying to find an inefficiency in the system.
Yes. And, you know, I spoke to a woman named Courtney Gregoire who works for Microsoft. She works in their digital crimes unit. She told me, first of all, they get about 12,000 complaints a month. And that's Microsoft alone of people saying, hey, I got the scam phone call or I got connected to
12,000.
Yeah. So that's just people getting Windows scams. So
and that's just the people who decided to tell Microsoft about it.
Right. And she also said that, you know, 2/3 of people in the world, they did a global survey a couple of years ago, 2/3 of people in the world have come up against these kinds of scams, either pop-ups or emails or phone calls. There are government agencies in the U.S., in other countries, and in places like India, where a lot of these call centers are based, that are working to try and stop this. But really, the thing that will make a difference is sort of consumer education. People just need to be, unfortunately, people just need to be less trusting, I think.
That is a sad, dark note to semi-end this on. All right, so any other clues that you can give us besides that there will be many surprises this Thursday?
Let me see.
This will break the internet, considering how many people have been watching and listening to the details about this.
My executive producer will kill me if I give too much away. All I can say is that we do meet Kamal.
You do meet Kamal.
Yeah.
That's insightful right there. And if you know who Kamal is the central character, again, the Reply All podcast, this is a cliffhanger between episode 101 and 102 or 102
and
103?
102 and 103.
So you've had 101 of these episodes, and this is your most successful one?
so far, I mean, knock on wood, it will be one of many more successful ones in the future.
Have you received a lot of feedback from people saying, hey, this happened to me, or have you look at this one?
I think part of the success is just that, you know, like I said, 2/3 of people have experienced this. So people who've never heard our show before and don't know who we are and think we're a couple of clowns behind a microphone, they definitely identify with with that experience. And right. Have that same frustration.
I am one of the people who was introduced to this podcast just because of this. I credit Emily Carpo, senior producer at the NewsHour, who texted me yesterday saying, you have to listen to this. I don't think she was racial profiling because I'm Indian, but it was a fantastic listen, and I am a new subscriber of yours. So thanks so much for doing this.
Yeah, thanks for having me.
All right, on Facebook Live, thank you for all your questions, and you have one nugget that has not been previously published, which is that they will meet Kamal in India on next Thursday's episode. So thanks for watching, and thanks for all your questions, and share it if you like it. I'm Hari Srinivasan. Thanks for watching.